day number something of quarantine, and my hair is in desperate need of a cut, a trim, because look at this. I can't even see anything right now. I've actually had to resort to using a hair clip to keep the bangs out of the face. There we go. See, I look silly, but I can actually see. So I usually just keep this on, and nobody knows. Hello, Internet. This is Olin from What I'm Listening To. Hope you all are staying safe, staying healthy, keeping those hands nice and clean during this quarantine time. It is currently Monday, and I'm here home alone while the lady is at work, and I figured this is the perfect opportunity to set up here and record yet another video. But for today's video, I'm actually not going to be talking about CDs. I am going to be talking about digital albums that never got CD releases. As a lot of music fans know, there are tons and tons of bands, especially newer bands, that are embracing the digital services out there, SoundCloud, Bandcamp, just putting stuff out on iTunes, whatever, and are opting out not to release anything on the physical format. And as a CD collector, that saddens me because I love collecting CDs. And though I'm not anti-digital by any means, I do enjoy buying bands' albums on a physical format, CDs especially. Occasionally, I will buy the vinyl. I don't often buy cassettes, but if there's a CD, I will typically get it. But over the years, I have discovered numerous bands that have only put their stuff out on digital format. Maybe they've released it on cassette or vinyl, but no CDs. So I've come up with a small list of these said bands and albums I like by them, and I'm going to talk about them here on the vlog. This might turn into a multi-volume series because, again, there are so many great bands out there that have never released anything on CD, but we're just going to start with this one for now, see how it goes, and go from there. So, with all that being said, let's jump into the albums. And to start things off, Internet, we're going to be talking about The Death Grips, more specifically their album, The Government Plates. Now, I have talked about this band many, many, many times on the vlog, but for whatever reason, if you've never heard of them, then let me give you a quick rundown of them. The Death Grips are an experimental hip-hop trio that incorporates elements of industrial, punk, digital hardcore, and just all-around chaotic noise, and basically it's personified anger. And they have definitely embraced that title, doing things like trolling their fans online, doing these weird and wacky art projects, one of which they did a show live while they were on Skype, and then going as far as even releasing their albums for free when they were supposed to be released on their label. All of the band's main albums have been released on CD, except this one. This, for whatever reason, they did not ever press on CD. Instead, they released it on their website for free, which you can still download. You've got to be kidding me. They did release the album on vinyl as a Record Store Day exclusive, but it's really difficult to come across a copy of those, and if you do, it's probably a lot of money. So this album is basically just a digital exclusive. Though it's common for their fans to argue which Death Grips album is the best, this one is regarded as kind of down there on the list. Albums like The Money Store, No Love, Deep Web, and Jenny Death and all those ones are amongst the top favorites. This one, I feel like, is the underdog. And the funny thing is, of all the Death Grips albums I've listened to, this one might just be my favorite. I held off on listening to this record for such a long time, and part of it was because people weren't really talking highly of it. But eventually, I reached a point where I had listened to everything else by the band, and The Government Plates was the last thing I had yet to listen to, so I decided to jump in on it. It is definitely one of their more experimental sounding albums, And in a weird way, the vocal work is far more minimal in comparison to their early stuff. And a lot of fans criticize this because they feel like MC Ride may have just been phoning it in or just wasn't around, but for whatever reason, it just works, at least in my mind. I'm really sad that it's not available on CD, but the moment the band decides to put it out, I will be getting a copy. The next album I want to talk about today, I want to talk about Water Witches by The Rainforest Spiritual Enslavement. Just because the name of the project is so long, I will be referring to them as just Rainforest, to keep it simple. Rainforest is one of Dominic Furnau's many, many side projects. He is most notable for his project Prurient, which he does all sorts of dark, ambient, industrial-sounding music. Rainforest is pretty similar sounding to that of Prurient, but, as the title of the project suggests, they incorporate a lot more field recordings of a rainforest. There's sort of this tribal element to it. They play with the theme of witches and black magic. And it all sounds like this gritty, dark, spooky-sounding material that could easily fit into a horror movie soundtrack. Dominic is still putting out material under the Rainforest name. In fact, some of his later works actually did get pressed on CD. In fact, I think I have one somewhere in here. I might have even talked about it in a vlog. Here it is, right here. All the early stuff he put out under the project name, it was all only released as a cassette or digital. It started out with numerous volumes of cassettes, usually consisting of 3 or 4 tracks apiece. But eventually, he released all that early work as one big compilation, and that's where we have Water Witches. The moment I discovered the project, I bought Water Witches immediately. And like I said, I'm sad that it's only been released as a cassette compilation. I don't have anything against cassettes, but if I were to buy a physical copy of it, I would prefer CD. But I'm totally okay with the digital copy that I bought. I go back to it every so often, especially during the Halloween time. If you're a fan of Prurient or just industrial music in general, I highly recommend checking this project out. The next album I want to talk about today, I want to talk about Halastrana's Compendium. Halastrana is another fantastic experimental project fronted by guitarist Stephen R. Smith. Stephen has gotten involved in so many different projects, some of which sound similar to one another, but overall I think the idea that he's going for is he's playing with a different style of guitar-based music. Halastrana is a project where he writes songs that are heavily influenced by Eastern European folk music. Not only that, he incorporates elements of ambience, field recordings, a little bit of drone here and there. It's folk music that I absolutely adore. I love Eastern European sounding music. There's something about it that's just so mystical and magical, and I can't really just put my finger on it, but I just can't get enough of it. The moment I discovered the project, I bought every single album of theirs. I kid you not, I have all of the albums of his in my collection because of that. But this particular album was never actually released on any physical format. No CD, no cassette, no vinyl. And strangely enough, I think it might be my favorite in the discography, which is even weirder because it's a compilation of early singles and stuff that were initially released as 7-inches. But for some reason, I just can't get enough of it. I've listened to all the other records that he's done under the project's name. I love them, but this one I just keep coming back to. All I'll say is if any of what I've described sounds appealing to you, please listen to this project. It is so very good. You can start with this one, but frankly, you could jump into any of the records and you're not going to be missing much at all. My hope is you would want to hear more after listening to at least one thing. And like I said with the others, if this is ever released on CD, I'm buying a copy of it immediately. Next album I want to talk about True That by Michael Cera. This is one of those really weird releases I stumbled across when I first discovered Bandcamp, and it was so bizarre that I couldn't help myself but to buy it. It's kind of like sometimes you just buy albums because there's something strange about it, whether it be the cover, whether it be the name of the band, the album name, or it's just got a weird sound. Whatever the reason, I had to buy this on his Bandcamp just because it's Michael Cera. And as it turns out, it's actually pretty good. If you're curious what a guy like Michael Cera could possibly be making, well, it's basically just a mishmash of weird little electronic experiments, some folk ditties, some ambient stuff. I'd like to say it's just a random mixtape of various recordings he's taken over the years. At one point, he covers the Blaze Foley song Clay Pigeons, which kind of sounds like something you'd hear in one of his movies. It's lighthearted, it's cheeky, but it's still a fun little song. It might not be for everybody, but if you are a fan of Michael Cera, I recommend giving it a listen. At least go check out his Bandcamp. I'll leave a link to it in the description below. Give it a listen. I'd love to hear what you think. Leave a comment down below too if you've checked it out. I'm tired of running around looking for answers to questions that I already know. I could build me a castle of memories just to have somewhere to go. The next album I want to talk about, Sunday Brunch by a band called Chapel. Chapel is a band that I actually saw live opening for Super Whatever. Though Super Whatever was the headliner, I honestly think that Chapel stole the show. The first opening group goes up and they're this great pop punk band, they're wild, they're having fun, they get off the stage, and then up comes these two people, boy and girl, one of which is a drummer, and the other is on electronics, bass, guitar, and vocals. They set up, they're having a hard time getting the sound they want, but eventually, once they start going, they ended up being an absolute blast. Initially, when they were setting up, I thought the vocalist was gonna be this introverted, aloof dude who wasn't really gonna be moving much on stage. But as soon as he started singing, he's up there, he's dancing, he's having a good time, and yet his composure is completely straight-faced. Not to mention, the drummer was probably one of the fiercest drummers I've ever seen perform live. And I've seen a lot of bands, but she was definitely up there, and slightly aside from their music, but during the show, they actually brought two people on stage so one of them could propose to their fiance in front of everybody, which then they used to segue into playing their song Ushigushi, which sadly is not on this album, but you can find a lot of footage of them playing it live on YouTube. So needless to say, I bought this EP just to support them. It's really the only thing they've released aside from a handful of singles. I guess the way I would describe their sound would be new wave, indie-tronica, maybe punk. It's hard to say. Their live stuff definitely sounds much more punky than their studio work, but however you hear them live or in the studio, it's solid no matter what. I am really, really hoping they put out a full-length release at some point in the near future, particularly featuring that song Ushigushi. I can't get enough of that song, it's fantastic. Look for a link to a place where you can listen to this EP in the description below. Give it a listen, let me know what you think in the comments too. I love them. I think I'm in love with you. It's true. I can't get enough of you. Don't you love me too? Staying on the topic of opening bands, the next album I want to talk about Of Loving Grace by the band Flying Circles. Flying Circles are a band hailing from Oakland, so they're a little bit local for me. I saw them live opening for AJJ way back in the day, and like Chapel, I thought they stole the show. There was something about the atmosphere they created that was far more appealing to me than the aggressive folk punk nature of AJJ. But what was even cooler was one of the members of AJJ, I think either the guitarist or bassist, was performing with Flying Circles as their electronic and sound manipulator guy. Needless to say, after hearing their set, I immediately became a fan. But sadly, they're one of those bands that's so obscure that they only ever released this one album, digitally and on cassette, and they haven't released anything since. I've gone back to this album numerous times and still love it, and I think it did a really good job capturing the live sound that I first heard the band do. And that's the thing about discovering bands by hearing them perform live. In the moment, you're seeing their performance, you're hearing their sound, you're loving every bit of it. You make a mental note to go buy their album at their merch stand or go support them on Bandcamp, and then when you get to that point, you hear the studio recordings, and it just sounds a little bit different. And there have been numerous occasions where I have been disappointed by that. Chapel actually was one of those, although their studio stuff ultimately grew on me. But when I heard the Flying Circle studio album, I was so stoked that it sounded exactly like how they sounded live. I highly recommend checking out this album. It's easily one of my favorite obscure bands. It's a band that I will put on in certain settings in hopes that someone will be like, "Whoa, what is this? I really like this." Go support them. Link to their Bandcamp below in the description. They're the best. The next album I want to talk about, Tricentennial 2076 by Vito B. This album is a relatively new discovery for me, and it is one of the most unique sounding folk records I've ever heard. It's just one dude playing guitar and piano singing these crazy songs about a dystopian society, Big Brother watching, the government, all these very scary sounding subjects that could be pretty relevant to today. The intriguing thing about this record too is not a whole lot is known about this guy. I wanted to do a little bit of research on this guy before talking about him on this video, but there were little to no sources I could find. There was one article written for a Chicago newspaper that kind of talked about who he was and all the weird stuff he was doing, but for the most part, the guy made two records and then completely slipped away. This record is incredible. It was released in 76 only on vinyl, and then eventually it was re-released digitally, but there are no CD copies available. It's one of those albums, though, that I feel like a label like the Numero Group or Light in the Attic will eventually get the rights to, remaster, and re-release it for a bunch of different formats. In fact, if anybody from those labels are watching this, please, please reissue this album. It is definitely worth listening to. I get massive sci-fi vibes from it, a la Fallout or Blade Runner. Such a cool record, highly recommend checking out. I'll leave a link down below for you guys to listen to. It's the best. Only through space love. And the last things I want to talk about today come in three albums. I want to talk about the Homestar Runner soundtrack, volumes 1 through 3. Although it is kind of weird, these are the albums I am the most excited to talk about. In fact, it was the main inspiration for making this video. I have been a fan of Homestar Runner for ages. I remember first discovering them through my neighbor when I was in like 7th grade, and he would show me these weird flash animations of a show called Teen Girl Squad. We used to sit in his living room and just watch those episodes over and over and over again. Eventually, I discovered the Homestar Runner website and would explore it for hours just watching every single tune they put out. There was a time in my life where I would log onto the family desktop and I would open three tabs. It would be YouTube, it would be roosterteeth.com, and it would be Homestar Runner. And to this day, I can still reference a good majority of those cartoons, even though it's been like 10 plus years. These soundtracks are incredible. They not only feature the sing-along songs that have appeared throughout the series, but they also have just random background songs that were used for introductions of tunes. For me, as a fan of both the website and music, I love stuff like that. There have been many times where I've been watching a cartoon or some random television show, and I hear the background track they're using that was probably composed specifically for the show, not intended for release, and I just love it. And when those moments happen, it's really sad because I know for a fact that I probably won't be able to get those MP3s of those songs, because again, they were probably composed for the show, they probably thought nobody's going to be listening to this, they just need something to fill the background or use as a segue or whatever. But the fact that the Brothers Chaps had the foresight to release all that stuff in with these soundtracks, I applaud them, and I love them so much for doing it. Years prior to these being released, the only musical thing you could get of theirs was the Strong Bad Sing CD. In fact, I think I have it somewhere. Hang on one sec. Here it is, right here. Strong Bad Sings. I've had this CD for years. Looks like it was released in 2003. Holy shit, 17 years ago. This CD has so much classic Strong Bad Homestar Runner stuff in the universe. Trogdor, The System Is Down, The Strong Badian National Anthem, a live cut of Everybody to the Limit. God damn, I listened to this thing nonstop. And there's some tracks on here that might be considered throwaways just because they're kind of silly and whatever. But if I put this album on, I could probably sing along to every single cut on it. I even got a limousine sticker that I stupidly stuck on the back of the booklet here, but meh, whatever, it adds to it. To wrap up my nerdy spiel, these albums are excellent. I am so, so happy that they were released. I think they were released like maybe a couple days ago, but regardless of the time, so happy they came out. I bought them the moment I saw them. Anybody who's a fan of Homestar Runner needs to check these out. There's at least one thing on here that you will love. Alrighty then, internet, that does it for me. Thank you all so much for watching. If you like this video, be sure to hit that subscribe button. It'll show me the support and I'll love your face for it. And you can also follow me on Instagram for even more music. I post a new album on there semi-frequently, talk a little bit about it, and it gives you a bit of an insight of what else is in my collection. So, thank you all so very much for watching. Be safe, be healthy, keep those hands clean. This is Olin from What I'm Listening To, signing out. Goodbye.
Come on for Hogwarts, everybody to the limit, the cheat is to the limit.